My name's Martin Reed. When I was around about seven, obviously I was living with my parents. We lived in a little village called Kingsclere. The house was surrounded mostly by fields. This story concerns partly my brother, who was at university at the time, and he came home to stay with a friend of his who was an artist. Now, this artist had a large number of paintings with him, paintings of the Egyptian cat god Bashed. And he needed somewhere to store these paintings while he was staying. And for some reason, I don't know what the reason was, they decided, everybody apart from me, decided that these paintings should be stored in my room, bearing in mind that I was seven. So anyway, these paintings were stored in my room overnight, and I was went to bed at the usual sort of time. And at some point during the night, I woke up to see the patch of moonlight cast by my window, which had a light curtain on it. And in the middle of the patch of moonlight was what seemed to me indisputably the shadow of a cat. This shadow, well, it was of a cat. And we did have a cat. So I naturally thought, well, the cat was standing somewhere, or sitting rather, somewhere. The moonlight was shining in the window and casting the shadow of our cat onto my wall. It's an obvious thought. But I was somewhat nervous, and so I actually got up and switched the light on and looked round for our cat. The cat was not in my room anywhere. I looked under the bed, I looked everywhere that I could look, and you know, the paintings of the Egyptian cat god Bashed were still there, unfortunately. But there was our actual cat was not in that room, so she was not jumping up onto the windowsill to cast that shadow. There was nothing out of the window. There was no cat. There was no cat on the floor. There was, well, no cat to be seen. I switched the light off again. The moment I switched the light off, there was the shadow of the cat. Being cast by what? I could see nothing that could cast a shadow even, let alone the shadow of a cat. I went to bed, staring at this shadow, wondering if I could stand it. When I couldn't stand it, I got up, switched the light on, searched the room, moved my books, looked behind the bookcase, what have you, looked out the window. No cat. No cat anywhere. Switched the light off, there was the cat, or rather the shadow of the cat. Went on several, this happened several times. In the end, a very strange thing happened, is that I just got used to the idea that there was this shadow of a cat, and I would not be able to explain why it was there. I covered my head with my blankets and went to sleep.
So my name's Alex Hull. I believe that I saw a ghost, a man, when I was about 8 years old. I was with a friend called Sarah, and we'd been just playing around, and it was nearly our bedtime, and it was dark outside. We were staying with her grandmother, and we both were looking out the window for whatever reason, and we saw this silhouette of a man. He was an old man with a beard, and there was no colour. He was just in black and white. It was just sort of a short glimpse, and then he just disappeared. And we were both still looking at it, and he sort of just disintegrated. And we briefly spoke about it afterwards, and both said, "Did you see that?" And sort of brushed it off as though we hadn't seen it, but we knew we both had, and it was quite creepy.
My name is Natalie Pfeffer. My first story I suppose, began when I was about 17. And for reasons unknown, I started to see the back end, the back legs and tail of a cat. And the cat might wind itself around my legs or be going through a doorway. And I've seen this cat periodically, perhaps with gaps of 5 or 6 years, throughout my life since. There doesn't seem to be any reason why. Nothing particular is happening in my life at the time generally. But having been concerned about it, I think, when I was younger, I now find that when I do see it, it's quite comforting. It's not a cat I recognise, but it's become familiar as the years have passed. And I don't know why it appears, but it doesn't really matter now. It's just something familiar in my life that's cropped up.
My name is Geidre, and the story happened a while ago, probably around 25 years back in Lithuania. I was just a little girl then, and we had a neighbor, an elderly lady, who was always making us beautiful Easter cake. And I once had a dream that she stands on my doorstep with a beautiful large cake in her hands. Although something was quite unnatural, she was wearing an old towel around her head, that towel, and it felt like she's uncomfortable with that towel. And that's it, that was the dream. We haven't seen her for a few days after that, or maybe 1 week, and then she was found in her flat dead, and she died because of stroke.
My second story is perhaps not so inexplicable. There's an obvious psychological explanation, but like many of these stories, it certainly didn't feel like that at the time. It was shortly after my father died, in fact, and I was lying in bed, semi-asleep, I suppose. It was early morning. This was perhaps 20 years ago now. I was lying face down, as I remember, and I felt that my father was actually sitting on top of me. That was the feeling I had. And I couldn't move because he was quite a large person. And I kind of looked backwards and could just about see a black shadow. My father almost always wore a black suit, dark suit. And then the feeling dissipated. Now, obviously, there's a psychological explanation that my father had been sitting on me psychologically for most of my life, or all my life and a lot of his, and he probably wasn't going to cease doing that just because he was dead.
My name is Dean Jones. Story I want to tell is from when I was about 5 years old. I was then, as I am now, a wee bit wonky, physically speaking. Mangled, I think is one of the polite words for it. I had just discovered an amazing technique. I could look at images on a sheet of paper and translate arcane markings into phonetic speech using my brain. Some people call it reading, and I got the hang of it very quickly. My dad liked to encourage such endeavours, so he decided to take me to a place full of books. Most people, that'd be the library. Dad, it was Hale Mwai, which you may know is like the book capital of, well, the universe, quite frankly. Almost every shop there is a secondhand bookshop. They've got dedicated shops for travel books, manuals, that sort of thing. I only just started reading, but I knew of Narnia, Oz, Wonderland, and I was always looking for them. You know, places like this, for instance. I went through a little old door, and it actually worked. Everything was different. The colours were bright, vivid. There were people wearing almost see-through clothes, and I was 5 years old. The fact they were see-through wasn't that intriguing to me at that point, honestly. The trees were close and far away at the same time. And they seemed more three-dimensional than normal, and yet when I touched them, they were flat. I saw this woman come up to me, beautiful, truly beautiful, wearing a toga of, as I now know, organza. Next thing I know, I'm being whisked away, and probably for the best. I was dragged, and I thought I saw my dad momentarily. Then there was flashing, strong lights, a horrible, horrible noise. Next thing I know, there's this man with no mouth putting something in my mouth, a tube, ramming it down. I couldn't see eyes. I could just see one big, glowing, silver eye staring back at me. And then the weirdest thing, I'm home, in bed, 2 days have passed. I wanted to get back to the safe place, the beautiful place where things were real and not real at the same time, with the very pretty, kind-looking lady in the toga. So I started reading more. I found out more of Narnia, of Oz, of Wonderland, and became obsessed in reading them. I became obsessed with the ethereal. I became a tailor, specifically to try and recreate that day. I was explaining all this once to my dad, who told me a very different story. He was a young man rebuilding a Suzuki motorcycle, and he needed a manual for it. So he decided to take his family, including his very young son, who just had extensive surgery to give him the ability to walk, up to Heung Mai. Whilst in one of these books perusing a bike manual, he looked down to see that his son had gone, and he realized he'd half crawled through a door to the outside air, open air Shakespeare Theatre's view of Midsummer Night's Dream. The star of the show, a young lady playing Titania, saw this young boy walk in during the production and was trying to make sure he was okay before he grabbed his errant offspring and looked him in the eyes and saw they were very glazed over. He wondered aloud how long it had been since he'd given him the very strong opium-based painkiller medication. 20, 25 minutes. He looked over to his young wife, who looked horrified, because she'd given it to him half an hour ago. And they suddenly realized that their young child had been given a morphine overdose in the middle of nowhere in a book festival. Ambulances were called, flashing blue lights, sirens, whisked off to a hospital where a man with a surgical mask and a big silver old-fashioned reflector in his headband induced a stomach pump into the young child, who was then sent home to sleep it off, and he slept for over a day. So it could be said my search for the ethereal is nothing more than a junkie's search for their first ever trip. This could be baby's first acid experience. And my life has been about recreating that one feeling, which may have been drug-induced indeed. But fortunately, I've had plenty of chances to have it in a clear, lucid mind now.
I wanted to talk about a dream that I had about, I suppose, 6 or 7 years ago. When I was a child, we lived in quite a quiet village, and there was a lady over the road who was very good friends with my parents. And I think she realised that I was quite a lonely, solitary child, and she used to get me to run errands, have me over to her house, and she was a wonderful character. She'd been a dancer on the stage in London. She was a very attractive woman, wonderfully eccentric. And one of the things that I used to do for her was walk her dog, and this went on for, I don't know, a couple of years probably, for bits and pieces of pocket money. I grew up, left home, didn't keep in touch, and I saw her once briefly at a wedding when she was about 80, and although she turned up in a wheelchair being pushed by a nurse, she had on a silk trouser suit in black and white stripes. Time passed again, didn't keep in touch, and then one night I had a dream that it had snowed quite deeply, and I woke up and the light reflected from the snow by the moon was coming in my bedroom window. And I could hear someone crunching around the side of the house in the snow, but moaning to themselves, being irritated and quite annoyed. And I thought, well, who the hell's that? And I got up, went to switch the light on, but the power had gone. So I came downstairs in the dark where I could look across, and I had quite a nice window looking out onto the garden. And standing outside this window a few feet back was a shadowy figure, moaning to themselves. But with its paws up on the windowsill was this blinking dog that I had taken for walks when I was 11 and had not thought about since. Instantly, I knew who the dog was or what it was, remembered its name, and it spoke to me and said that Flip, it was Flip's time to die, but that she didn't want to go, and it wanted me to talk to her and tell her that it was okay and that she shouldn't feel anxious about it. It was the right thing to do. And the dream ended, and I visited my dad probably within 48 hours, I think, and he told me that she had died. And I don't know, I felt good, really, about being asked, if I was asked, to help her transit to wherever, but also blessed in a way that it had been me that the dog had asked, and I just hoped that her passage to wherever was relaxed in the end.
My name's Karen, and when I was 17 years old, I was at my friend's birthday party. In fact, it was our joint birthdays, but it was her 18th birthday party. She was a year older than me. She lived in a little village called Manudon, which is in the middle of the back of beyond, somewhere between Bishop Stortford and Stansted, where the airport is now. And because it was quite a way away and I'd gone on my own, her mother had said I could stay over. They lived in a 17th century farmhouse, and when I woke up in the middle of the night, there was a wardrobe in the corner. I don't think there was much furniture in the room, it was probably a wardrobe in the corner. There was a chest of drawers somewhere. And what I wasn't expecting was this old, literally grey lady standing there looking over me. She was benign, I think. I don't think there was any sort of feeling that she would have hurt me. But of course, being 17 years old and not used to seeing anything like that, I just quickly hid under the bedclothes and I didn't come out till the next morning. When my friend got up and, you know, sort of chatting about what had happened overnight, she said to me that actually, when she was a child, her mother had gone to visit the grandmother who lived in a bungalow. They'd built a bungalow on the farm grounds for the grandparents to go and live in. So when my friend's mother was visiting grandma, my friend said that she was in bed because she hadn't been very well. And so she said that a little old lady came and actually gave her a glass of water. And so it kind of proves the point that there was something, a spirit of some sort in that house. And being 17th century, it could have been anyone. And I never did find out who it was.
I'm Luke Nash, and I'm telling a story courtesy of my grandparents from the 1960s. In the 1950s, my grandparents used to live in a farmhouse out in the countryside of Essex, and they considered it an especially eerie place to live. One reason for this was that all the ashtrays dotted about the house were broken by some unknown presence. This was with the exception of one ashtray, the one that was left outside, which for some reason was never broken, but all the others were smashed without any cause. Another eerie event that happened in the house was that my grandmother was once cleaning in the living room, and she heard my grandfather enter the room. She began conversing with him, but upon turning around, she realised there was no one there.
My name's James Sarek. And this particular event happened to me around 15 years ago whilst on holiday in Wales. Now, my family and I used to go on holiday every year to a place called Penython Hall, and there are around 30 rooms in this house. And one of the corner bedrooms, the West Wing, was known for being having a sort of an eerie presence, rather a cold presence in the room. And I remember when I was 10, I stayed in that room with my brother. And that we both felt, across the two or three nights we were staying there, a cold, eerie presence was in the room. And that on the final night, we both sort of stayed awake to see whether there indeed was a presence in the room. And we heard floorboards creak, and a chill sort of came over both of us, one we hadn't felt previous evening.
This story happened when I was in my early 20s, and I was living in a house with my boyfriend, and for, I don't know, no reason, I became conscious of a wardrobe that was in our bedroom. It was quite an old wardrobe, probably an antique, nicely made, big, heavy, patterned wood. And I started to feel uncomfortable about this wardrobe over a period of weeks until it got to the point where I felt bad undressing in front of it, which may sound mad. I don't know, I didn't feel comfortable with it at all. And this feeling grew in intensity until I found it difficult to sleep in the room properly. I can't even remember the year, but it was the night Alex Higgins won the snooker, for everybody's reference. And I had gone to bed on my own, and sometime later, when I was asleep, my boyfriend came up to join me and opened the door quietly so as not to wake me. But I was awoken by the door slamming violently, and him then sitting down heavily on the bed. He said he'd opened the door quietly so as not to wake me, but it had been ripped out of his hand and slammed. And as he turned round, at the end of the bed was a small boy reading a book. Now, he described him as a choir boy. But when he sat down on the bed, which was more in shock at having seen this figure, somebody shouted the word "shout" really loudly in his ear, and that was the end of the sequence. But it did take the wind out of his sails, because he wasn't perceptive to my feelings about this wardrobe and whatever malevolence or odd stuff was going on with it. But we moved quite shortly after that, and I don't know. I've got no real thoughts about what that was all about. Just a sequence of odd events.
My name is Belinda Federl, and this happened during the Lent period of this year. Instead of giving up, I wrote 40 poems for Lent and attended a Lent course for the first time. And although I felt quite spiritual during this time, I also felt that I've been psychically attacked. It felt as if I was being watched. At the corner of my eyes, I could see flickers of someone or something, and I felt sometimes a certain menace. I don't know, there was a certain amount of fear and trepidation around. And I Googled something called the Grey Men, and that seemed to fit what this might be. Grey Men can be just passive, they can be menacing. And I'm a Christian, so to recognise evil is to bring evil into your life, but there again, we have to fight evil now and again. So, it was just while the weather was turning, it was hot, it was sultry, the nights were humid, and I couldn't sleep well. And this was like a dream. One of those dreams where you feel that you're awake, you know it's not real, but it's happening. And it started with a telephone call. And I heard a voice, and it was oily, it was charming. It brought all that fear and disgust that I had hidden within me. To put this in context, my marriage ended quite reasonably violently and mentally, physically, it was domestic violence, and I ran to Colchester. And this voice was my ex-husband. And I thought I had put so many protected layers around me and built up walls that he didn't have the power to hurt me anymore, but he brought it all back. And like dreams do, you are sometimes transported into another place. So next, I was in my bed, and he was there whispering in my ear, daring me to speak. It was calm, but confrontational, like being in an eye of a storm. We see all the stress and the magnetic things around you. He was daring me to speak, but I couldn't. I felt that I could reach out and touch him. He felt that real. And I was just rooted. I couldn't move. And I had so much fear inside of me. And then I just heard a ricochet of the door slamming, a familiar sound. And I felt galvanized. I had to go after. I ran down the steps of my flat and into the street. And it was like a twilight night, a misty night. And the shadow just went like a wisp. But it left me trembling with fear.